Well, I think it's known to everybody that after the new government came into power, the Make in India has taken a giant stride, and we can see some visible improvements in the defense sector, in defense industry in particular. So, but the presentation I'm going to give is, there are some initiatives have already been taken, but there are some more that needs to be taken, and that will actually be more crucial for sustaining or creating a vibrant defense industrial base. Well, giving a small overview of the Indian defense industry, we have a very fairly large defense industry in terms of infrastructure and in terms of employment. In fact, if you compare the number of people employed in Indian defense industry, that is comparable with the figures with many European countries like France and UK. We have nine big defense public sector undertakings, 39 plus 2 which are in the offing, ordnance factories. Then we have 50 odd defense laboratories under the DRDO. Then we have a private sector which is small but very growing. So some statistics are shown here. Some 300 industrial licenses have already been given to more than 150 companies. But I believe around 50 companies have started producing defense items. Despite having this huge setup, unfortunately, the industry has not been able to meet the defense requirement of the armed forces. I have put a small graph here. You can see the procurement budget for the last 5-7 years and the indigenous supply. So unfortunately, although we talk more about the private sector, there is not a comprehensive database to capture the supplies of the supplies from the private sector. This is a fact which has been accepted by the government also. So I have only, but anyway, the private sector has not actually contributed very meaningfully to the defense forces. So I have taken the supplies of the ordnance factories and the DPSUs, and you can see there is a huge gap between the requirement of the armed forces and the supplies from the DPSUs and the ordnance factories. The gap is around 40,000 crore every year, and that gap is increasing every year. So there is a huge opportunity for the private sector. And the point that I would like to emphasize is that since we are not, as an indigenous industry, is not able to meet the requirements, we have to depend on the foreign sources. So I have given some figures here for the last 3 years up to 2013-14. So we have spent around 80,000 crore on direct imports from various sources. As I said, the Modi government has taken some concrete measures under the Make in India initiative umbrella. They have increased the FDI from 26 to 49%, although its impact is yet to be seen. They have streamlined the industrial licensing procedures to the extent that there is no pending, huge pending number of industrial licenses with the government. Then the government has articulated the defense export strategy along with the detailed no objection certificate requirements. To some extent, the level playing field, which was absent earlier and it was a major irritant for the private sector, has been sorted out. The excise duty and the custom benefits, which were enjoyed by the DPSUs on non-factories, have been withdrawn from them. Now the public sector and the private sector on the same field. Now, more importantly, I think the government has reposed a great degree of trust and hope with the private sector. And I have listed some big profile, high profile equipments or the tenders for which the private sector is also considered to compete or the bid. And this is for the first time in Indian history that the private sector is considered to participate in such big projects. I think this is a huge boost for the private sector. And then, as you might know, that Dhirendra Singh committee was set up, and I think that report, has been well prepared, and it contains many 43 recommendations, of which 15 recommendations pertain directly to the Make in India. But if you look at the acquisition reforms, which the committee has suggested, so there will be a lot more which will have some impact on the indigenous industry, particularly the private sector. So these are the some initiatives already taken by the government. But more crucially, these are the pending reforms which government has to take into account for creating a self-sustaining defense industrial base. The biggest problem in our defense industrialization process has been, I think, is the lack of an institutional mechanism for defense manufacturing. Like, we have a lot of organizations and procedures for the acquisition or the procurement, but there has not been a single larger institution to take care of the defense manufacturing. So just to highlight We have various plans, starting with the long-term integrated prospective plan, then we have five-year services capital acquisition plan, we have annual acquisition plan, and to process and monitor those plans, we have various planning acquisition or procurement boards, like the Defense Acquisition Council or Defense Procurement Board, but all these are geared towards acquisition. But when it comes to indigenous manufacturing, there is none. So I think we need to have a high-powered committee. In fact, this is not a new idea or my idea. This is an idea which was generated in early 2001 when the group of ministers was set up, and that committee had suggested that we should have a high-powered committee under the Ministry of Defence, under the Defence Minister or the Raksha Mantri, whose job would be to draw long-term plans, set the target for the industry, monitor the progress, and more importantly, to bring all the stakeholders to a common cause. Now, since we don't have that kind of institution, we have surprises from time to time. If you remember, recently there was a news report pertaining to Indian Army's requirement for the FRCV, future requirement, future ready combat vehicles. The Army floated this RFI even after the government initiated its Make in India. And this has created some ruffle with the DRDO. DRDO is not really happy. But I think this is a surprise, and this will happen, continue to happen, unless there is a high-powered body to monitor what is happening within the industry. The second weakness in our system is absence of a long-term manufacturing plan. As I said, there is number of plans for acquiring systems, but there is no simultaneous plan, indigenization plan. So in fact, this has been also highlighted by many committees. Unfortunately, I didn't see this recommendation coming from the Dhirendra Singh committee, but previous committees have highlighted this point. So I think if there is a plan, long-term plan, and more importantly, this should be communicated to the industry so that the industry can come up with the industrial plans or the technology plans so that the phased manufacturing can take place in India. The third problem to my mind is the monopoly of R&D by one agency, that is DRDO. The model we have created in India by way of giving R&D, all the R&D work to one agency, I think has not helped much, although DRDO has done a lot of credible things. So for those strategic systems, developing those strategic systems, DRDO must be given credit of. But I think the model, we should go beyond that model. If you look at other countries like Israel, US everybody highlights, but I will talk of Israel. There is no counterpart of DRDO in Israel. There is only one agency that is called Office of Chief Scientist. They have only 30 program managers. Their job is to fund R&D to the most competent agencies. It may be industry, it may be academia, it may be public funded research institutes. And they identify the best place and they fund the money and the product, the R&D is developed there, the R&D is done there, and some product is developed. And the best thing is that the OCS, the Office of Chief Scientist, job is not to subsidize R&D. And they provide the money hoping that when the that R&D fructifies and gets converted into a product, and that when that product is sold, then the government will get back some royalty, some money in the form of royalty. In fact, 1/4 of the government's budget comes in the form of. I think the HR issues have been talked very in a detailed way in the previous session, so I will not talk of it. Then I think the another problem in our Indian setup is the lack of conducive financial framework. I think this is one thing that my previous speaker, Mr. Rahul Chaudhary, dwelt on very nicely, so I am skipping that. Then another problem is the lack of reforms in our established pairs. So as I said, we have huge setup, particularly in the private public sector. Those are the DPSUs and ordnance factories. Although they're huge in size, but their output is not so up to the requirement. And there is a need to reform these institutes. All said and done, these public sector undertakings whose turnover is more than 40,000 crore every year, you can't ignore them. So you have to systematically reform them. There have been many suggestions given by the previous committees, past committees, but unfortunately, those suggestions have not been implemented very seriously. And the last is, we have to streamline the offset policy. I think this is the one topic which was discussed thoroughly in the past two sessions, so I'm skipping that. So by way of conclusion, I have to say that we need a high-powered committee like the DAC, a counterpart of DAC in the defense, for the defense manufacturing. We need to have a long-term manufacturing plan, and that must be shared with the industry. The third is we have to promote R&D in the industry. So that has been a historical weakness in our system. So we have to sort that problem out. Then we have to also create skill development centers. So I know that the Dhirendra Singh committee has gone into details in recommending what needs to be done to promote skill development center. But one thing that has been missed out is the creating a defense specific technology university, and where the Prime Minister in his speech at the Aero India 2015 had promised that there would be a defense technology university, but nothing concrete has been seen so far. Then, as I said, we need to streamline or reform the DPSUs, Under Inspectors, and the DIDO, which have been talked of repeatedly by various committees, but not done so far. Then we have to streamline the offset policy to suit our indigenization requirement. That's all I have to say. Thank you.